I'm really enjoying the books and the authors that are coming into Magic at the moment. We've had a real great array of subjects and some fantastic authors and writers. And I'm really pleased because I've got the iconic Leslie Pierce in with me this afternoon. And we're going to be talking about her latest offering, which is called Forgive Me. Leslie, thank you for coming into Magic.
Well, thank you for calling me iconic.
Well, you are. You are. There are certain people that I call literary royalty. And I think you're one of those people.
What a lovely thing to say. I should dine out on that tonight.
You make sure you do and think of me while you're dining. Okay. Now, let's start with Forgive Me. Now, you've picked the 90s for the setting of this book, haven't you?
Yes.
But you're normally quite what I call period drama, like your early 90s.
Historical things.
Why the change for this book?
Well, it's actually pretty hard to do the research and write a historical book every year. So I intersperse them with ones that are more sort of current because there isn't quite so much research needed. I mean, there still is quite a lot for a book set in any period, but not as much as there is, say, set in the First World War or the Crimean War or the Klondike Gold Rush.
Hmm. Was it a better experience for you to do something in a different era?
I really like doing the historical ones, but okay. I quite enjoy doing this one as well. The thing is, I'm harking back to things in this book that happened back in the 70s, which is an era that I'm very fond of because that's when I was young, you know, and you can remember everything. And therefore, you know, you remember what the clothes were like and with the music and that sort of stuff. So that makes an awful lot easier. You feel comfortable in it, and there weren't mobile phones and people weren't on computers and all that sort of thing.
Yeah. We're a completely different nation now that...
Exactly. I wouldn't want to set a book now. Because, you know, if you were doing a sort of mystery, everything, what with all the different kind of forensic science and everything now and mobile phones and everything, I mean, I don't know how anybody can commit a crime now and get away with it.
Absolutely.
Let alone think one up.
We're being tracked in every device that we've got in our handbags. Okay, let's talk about the characters of this book. I'd like to know who your favourite is out of these three. Belle's War, The Promise, Matilda, Never Look Back, or Eva from this book. Who is the character that you're more connected to?
Belle, definitely.
Right, tell me why.
Yeah. Well, I always wanted to write about a bad girl that did, you know, that became a sort of prostitute or something because it just appeals to me.
And I won't ask why.
I don't know why. I've always liked bad people.
Yeah.
You know,
they're more
bad women, naughty
aren't they?
Women. With you know, the tart with a heart is my kind of a heroine,
I
you
like
know.
That one.
So Belle comes under that category, and I think that with working on her for two books, and I'm now doing a third one about her, I just feel like she's part of my family now. It's very, very hard. It will be very hard to let her go, ultimately, but she'll end up so old you won't want to read about her anymore, you know, when she's all sort of ratty. And
she might become interesting the older she gets.
I was very fond of Mattie as well, though, and Never Look Back. I mean, she was always my favourite until Belle. And in fact, Mattie was supposed to end up running a brothel in San Francisco, but she wouldn't let me. As we got halfway across the States, she made it quite clear she wasn't that kind of girl. So I had to have her rescuing fallen women instead.
Right. Stop right there. When you say she wouldn't let you, is it as you started to write about the character and as her character opened up?
They grow themselves.
Yeah, the outcome wouldn't have been fitting for what you had already made her.
But it seems that it's them that does it. They become what they want to become, you know. I know that sounds ridiculous, but it is actually true. They do. I mean, obviously, some deep-seated level inside me has decided she can't do that. But that's the way it comes across, that she's saying, no, I'm not that sort of person.
Now, Forgive Me, the book Forgive Me, it has a slight departure from your previous writing styles, not just because of where the era that it's set, but would you agree with that?
Mm. Well, people do say that each one of my books is quite distinct. I suppose that's just me growing, you know. As a writer, if you went back to my first books, they look a bit infantile compared with what I've done recently. Mm. I think that happens with everybody, doesn't it? There's no conscious effort to make it a different kind of story or anything.
Mm. So what inspires you to write then? When you sit down and say, right, I'm on my next book, where do you get that inspiration from? And when you start a character, do you know her journey and the outcome?
No.
It's just something that...
No, it kind of grows as it goes along. It usually starts with just a germ of an idea. I mean, one of my books, for instance, Hope, there was a pile of stones in the field opposite my house and, you know, where there had once been a cottage a long time ago. And I was just standing there one day sort of thinking, I wonder who lived there. And it would be a lovely place to have a house because it's got a beautiful view of a valley, you know, with a river at the bottom. And I started thinking about what they might have been like and where they worked and what they did, you know. And the next thing I know, I've got the daughter going off to work in the big house up the road, and maybe that the baby that was born the wrong side of the blanket was brought to live with them because she was the mistress of the house who shouldn't have been having a baby.
Carry on, I'm liking this.
And all this came with just being out with my dogs and just standing there looking at the pile of stones across the road. It just came out of nowhere. But I used to do this with my children when they were little. I mean, I would come home from work and say, well, you know, the elephants came in the cafe today and they were playing football with the cakes. And I know it wasn't too bad until the giraffes came in. And then I would elaborate on what happened to them. So I've kind of always told these far-fetched stories, you know. And, of course, to children, you put all the elements in that you know that they will like, you know. It's not that much different writing for adults, actually, because we all like those.
Anyway.
Yes, we want to be entertained. We want to be taken on a journey to somewhere where we haven't been before.
Yeah, I totally agree. And I love the fact, and I said this is one of the reasons why I started this book club. It just used to amaze me when I got on the train at Victoria in the evening, how you would watch people automatically put down the handbag or the briefcase and then a book would come out. And it's almost as though you could see by the way they were gripping the book just how engrossed they were getting. Because we love a good story, don't we?
Yes, we do.
We really do. And I've seen people miss train stops because
I've done it loads of times.
There you go. Because you're so engrossed. And as you're reading, it's almost as though this film is playing in your head. Mm. And it's just...
Well, I can remember reading The Thornbirds when my youngest was a baby and I was feeding her late at night, and the next thing I knew, the sun had come up and there she is at an empty breast and I'm still reading, and I've been there on a fairly uncomfortable chair all night.
Amazing.
And that was actually the moment when I thought, if I could write a book like that. I'd already was trying to writing short stories, but that was the moment when I thought, I'm going to try and write a book that grips you as much as that one.
That was your light bulb.
Mm.
Yeah. Brilliant, loving it. Now, Leslie, Hilary Duvet, I don't know if you know about this, but she recently said on Desert Island Discs that one of her luxuries would be a Leslie Pierce book. Did you hear about this?
I know. I nearly fell over when I heard it.
Oh, my God. But
I was in the kitchen and I heard this voice and I went, what?
But how wonderful, though.
Oh, fantastic.
Right,
yes.
Well, now that, okay, so you knew it, you heard it at the time. What did you do? So you're in the kitchen. What were you doing?
Well, I was cooking the lunch and... I think I sort of just stood there with a stupid great grin because I was alone in the house. There wasn't anybody to run it, and it would have looked a bit silly running down the road. So listen, anybody that happens to be about, you know. And then the phone started ringing and two or three of my friends had heard it as well, and they rang me and text messages came. And so I was able to share it, the glee, with other people. And yes, bless her, she actually told me afterwards that I kept her mother alive for an extra 3 years because her mother loved my books as well so much, which was very, very touching.
Lovely. And I think that is the magic, if you pardon the pun, of writing, that you will sit down at your assigned place or your appointed place where you choose to write, whether that be in the corner of a room, a set place, in the house, whatever, and you write, type, or whatever comes out of you. And then it transcends and resonates with people all over the world. And that's what I love about authors. And that's why we love the book club.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you so much for joining me. Leslie Pierce's book, Forgive Me, it's out now. It's fantastic. And so is this lady as well. Thank you very much. You're welcome.
It's a lovely thing to say.
Well, listen, we only have the best on this book club. Only the best.